The basic mission of the lab is to study individual differences in personality or temperament of the monkeys that we have in our colony and how genetic and environmental factors act, but actually much more importantly, interact in shaping individual developmental trajectories. So we basically watch monkeys grow up and vary their genetic background, and we also manipulate their environmental background. So the monkeys that are behind me right now are at our field station, which is our best effort to recreate what the situation would be for them in the wild. We have access to two field sites so we can compare how these monkeys grow up to what data come from studies in the wild. And then we have more restrictive laboratory settings where the groups are in large pens rather than in a 5-acre enclosure, where we can be much better able to manipulate various aspects of their environment. It's also easier to collect biological data from the monkeys in these more confined environments relative to getting biological samples from our monkeys out in the field. But we are able to compare what biological data we do get from these field monkeys with the ones up in the other parts of the lab. This group in particular is of interest because it's the equivalent to a small group of monkeys that you would find in the wild. In the wild, rhesus monkeys live in large social groups called troops that range in size from 30 or 40 individuals on the small end to over several hundred on the large end. But whether the troops are large or small, they all have the same basic social structure. Every troop is organized around several female-headed multigenerational families or matrilines, plus males who have come in from the outside. And this arrangement derives from the fact that rhesus monkey females stay in the group in which they're born for their entire life, whereas rhesus monkey males stay only until puberty, and then they leave, either voluntarily or they're physically kicked out. They typically join all male gangs, and then they try to work their way into a new troop. So every troop has plenty of adult males and adult females in it, but the females have all been there since birth, and they're all related to one another, at least within their respective families, whereas the males have been there only since puberty, and they're initially related to no one. Our situation here is when males come of age, we have to take them out of the group. Otherwise, life will be very unpleasant for them. We know that because when we only had one fence here, every single monkey that came of age went over the fence. The NIH director didn't like that, and that's why we have a second fence. But when males start showing up in the corridor, then we know it's time for them to be moved into other social situations. The other way, so this troop has three matrilines. That is three families that have been there for several generations, in addition to the males. In the wild, rhesus monkey troops also are characterized by dominance hierarchies, multiple dominance hierarchies. So, for example, there's a hierarchy between families, such that every member of the highest ranking family, including infants, outranks everybody in the next family, who in turn outrank everybody in the third family. Our matrilines differ in dominance hierarchy, so just like in the wild. A second dominance hierarchy you will see in the wild is within each family, where basically the rule is younger daughters outrank older daughters. And it's easy to see how this happens because the mother will preferentially defend her newborn daughter from a harassment of a jealous older sister. So even though the older sister is bigger or stronger, with the mother to back her up, that younger sister can get away with anything that she wants. Within each of the families out in this field station, we have exactly the same kind of hierarchy. Younger daughters outrank older daughters. There's a hierarchy among the males that are in a troop that's separate from the ones with the families. The different males in this group have their own hierarchy. And finally, there's a hierarchy among the infants that are born into the troop every year that roughly reflects the position in the troop of their mother. So it's not that some infants are bigger or stronger or smarter or quicker than other infants. Those differences undoubtedly exist. It's that other monkeys associate a particular infant with a particular mother and afforded equivalent social status. So what we have in our troop, which would be the equivalent of a mid-sized troop in the wild, is exactly that same kind of social structure, that same kind of dominance relationship among the monkeys. And so in that sense, it's a pretty good replication of what you would find in the wild, particularly given the fact that rhesus monkeys in the wild can live just about any place.